How many of you actually know where the origin of the Big Bang Theory came from? Well, it came from this Catholic priest or Jesuit priest, Georges Lemaître. And he was born in July of 1894, died in June 1966. And he was a Roman Catholic priest, astronomer, and professor of physics at this University Catholic. He was the first known academic to propose the theory of the expansion of the universe, widely misattributed to Edwin Hubble. He was also the first to derive what is known as Hubble's Law and made the first estimation of what is now called Hubble Constant, which he published in 1927, 2 years before the Hubble's article. Lemaître also proposed what became known as the Big Bang Theory of the Universe, which he called his hypothesis of the primeval atom or cosmic egg. So I'm going to play a little bit of this thing on there for you. Now remember, he called this his hypothesis, the primeval atom or the cosmic egg. Let's listen to this real quick.
The man who gave us the scientific concept of the Big Bang worked here, of all places, in this Belgian cathedral. Father Georges Lemaître, born in 1894, may be the most important physicist you've likely never heard of.
Lemaître was responsible for the idea that the universe not only is expanding, but that the universe has expanded from a dense state. He called it the primeval atom. Now we call it the Big Bang, but it was his idea.
The seed for the idea.
It was his idea, is what they say.
Came from Albert Einstein and his theory of general relativity in the early 20th century. But Einstein himself did not like it. Einstein felt more comfortable in a static, unchanging universe. But Lemaître took Einstein's chaotic, finite universe to its fiery origin.
If Einstein had had the courage of his convictions, in some sense, he would have recognized that the static universe he believed in was not compatible with the theory that he'd come up with.
In general relativity, Einstein proposed that mass warps space and time to create gravity. But if gravity is always pulling in, then what keeps everything from ultimately drawing together into one massive object? Einstein believed there must be another equal counterforce pushing out in opposition to gravity, keeping the eternal universe in perfect balance.
So what Einstein did was he tweaked his own equations with what is called the cosmological constant.
But Einstein was wrong. There was no yin to gravity's yang. Lemaître correctly believed that there was no cosmological constant. Instead, he found evidence of an expanding universe in Einstein's theories as he studied them in the mid-1920s.
Georges Lemaître took the original equations and saw that they contained solutions which represented an expanding universe. And of course, not too long after that, Edwin Hubble comes along and by his observation shows that the universe actually is expanding.
But what was behind this expansion that overcame the push of gravity? Lemaître proposed something absolutely radical. If the universe is expanding, then in the past it was smaller. Ultimately, in the distant past, it was infinitely small. A primeval atom, or cosmic egg.
Perhaps there was this cosmic explosion that set the universe into motion. So he would go to various conferences and tap people on the shoulder, and people would smile at him and, you know, basically humor the man.
So there we go. So he called that his theory, and he called it the primeval atom or the cosmic egg. Now remember, he was born in 1894. This is The Secret Doctrine by H.P. Blavatsky. This is published in 1888. So this was published before he was actually born. And so if we go to this page, we have the mundane egg. And it said, whence this universal symbol? The egg was incorporated into a sacred sign in the cosmogony of every people on Earth, and was revered on both account of its form and its inner mystery. From the earliest mental conceptions of man, it was known as that which represented the most successfully origin and the secret of being, the gradual development of the imperceptible germ within its closed shell, the inward working, without any apparent outward interference of force, which from a latent nothing produced an active something, needing naught save heat, and which, having gradually evolved into a concrete living creature, broke its shell, appearing to the outward senses of all self-generated and self-created being, must have been a standing miracle from the beginning. The secret teaching explains the reason for the reverence of the symbolism of the prehistoric races. First cause, which had no name in the beginnings, later it was pictured in the fancy of thinkers as an ever-invisible, mysterious bird that dropped an egg into chaos, which the chaos becomes the universe. Hence, Brahm was called Kalahansa, the swan in space and time. He became the swan of eternity who lays at the beginning of each Mahamanvaranta, a golden egg. It typifies the great circle, or O, itself a symbol for the universe and its spherical bodies. So there we go. So then we have the very beginning, the first cause, the mundane egg that was at the very beginning, and yet somehow this was his idea. This is from Wikipedia. The world egg, cosmic egg, or mundane egg is a mythological motif. So it's mythological now, but it's okay if they mention it, if the scientist mentions it, or the Jesuit priest mentions it. Found in the creation myths of many cultures and civilizations. Typically, the world egg is the beginning of some sort, and the universe, or some primordial being, comes into existence by hatching from the egg, sometimes laying on the primordial waters of the earth. And yet, this is his idea, they say. Well, if we scroll down further, we get this image right here of the expansion of the universe from a singularity. And all these ancient cultures knew about this as well, from this particular egg or this singularity. And if you take a look at this singularity right here, what it actually is, if we turn it over, we can see that the singularity is actually the same thing that's being shown to us on the pyramids. And the reason the capstone is missing is because the very beginning, which disappears into the unseen universe, they don't account for. That's why the capstone is missing. And when we take a look at the pyramid, it also relates to man as well, because man relates to the universe. We have the very upper part of the pyramid, which relates to the mind. We have this cosmos down here, but it all relates to man as well. But this is what they were showing us of the pyramids. If we take a look again right here, we can see that the peculiar architecture of the pyramid shows in itself the drift of the metaphysical thought of their builders. The apex is lost in the clear blue sky of the land and typifies the primordial point. So the primordial point is sitting at the very top of the pyramid, and the very top of the pyramid represents the singularity. And of course we have the antediluvian arch showing this as well. In this case, it's Orion, because there are smaller versions of this type of thing that happen in the universe. So the pyramid is actually a model of the Big Bang Theory. The mundane or cosmic egg was not originally discovered or thought up by Georges Lemaître, the Jesuit priest. It's been around forever. And the fact that he even used the word cosmic egg, and knowing that it was all over these cultures, should be a red flag. So if you want to know where your Big Bang Theory came from, it came from more than likely ancient Egypt and the ancient cultures. And the cosmic egg theory is found all over cultures. So that is where the scientific beginning of the universe, the Big Bang Theory, actually came from. It came from the mysteries in the ancient cultures. So you scientific folks out there, it might be good for you to know this kind of stuff, so that when you are trying to learn other things and trying to understand our universe better, you might take a few moments to look to the ancients. Y'all take care. Talk to you soon.
Okay, so I have some connections for you tonight, and I want you to pay close attention because this is going to kind of tie the Hindu culture to the Mayan culture to the Egyptian culture. And I'm not even going to go into the Kabbalah right now, but all of it is coming together. One of the things that we cannot seem to get from storytelling so much. Storytelling and the words that we see within these various ancient texts, they help us some, but they only help us as a supportive thing, in my opinion. More directly, it seems that art itself gives us more of the direct relationships between one culture and another than we would see otherwise. Because with the art that we can actually see the symbolism in different form, whether it be the symbolism of the creator god or whatever, the rituals that are performed and the associations that are made to them as well. It gets very deep, it gets very complex, but it gives us that direct association so that when we go to the text and start looking at the text and seeing what they have to say, then we are able to decipher them. Because one of the big problems that we've always had is that people take these religious texts and they interpret them literally, okay? And although sometimes it can partially be true that way, all I can say is it's very mysterious, because it kind of shades in between a literalism and almost something that's metaphorical. It's kind of hard to describe, but the art helps put it all together, okay? So in the Hindu religion, we have the creator god, Brahma, okay? Now, Brahma, in all of these various religions, what you'll see, and I'll leave a link to this for you, there is this, when creation begins, okay, it begins from this large, well, it's infinitely large, infinitely unknown. It's this one, what we might call the one, that everything that begins in this one large container. Nothing is outside of it, everything is contained within inside of it. The only way that it can create is to go within itself. Okay, so if you can just imagine a very large circle, right? And in that large circle, it wants to create something. And that creation begins with a dot that is inside that large circle, and that represents Kether, and it represents the first point. So we have this movement that occurs from what we might consider, who knows, all possibilities. These are usually labeled as 0, 00, and 000. And we can also see this in the Kabbalah, for example, when we take a look at Ein, Ein Sof, and Ein Sof R, okay? Which basically means, Ein is just limitless. And then we have Ein Sof, which is kind of the same thing, but kind of a more of a constricted way of that. And then Ein Sof R, which just means limited light. And then from limited light, which is still in the invisible portion, it's what's considered kind of like you might consider spirit. So we have this movement from completely unknown, and then it starts down this chain, and it moves down the chain, and the first thing it creates is what's called mind. Now, at this point, everything's still invisible. Okay, and then mind moves down, and then it creates a spark of itself. But so we have this movement from spirit down to mind, and then down into physical reality. That same kind of metaphor can also be used if you think about the way that things work psychologically in your own head. Okay, and this is very deep stuff. I know it's hard to take in, but this is the way it works. So I'm going to go into kind of the way it's described here in the Yoga Vasistha, and I've also got a video I'll link to for more of this information that's from the United Lodge of Theosophy, one of my featured channels that I have. So let's get started. So if you go to Wikipedia, you'll see that Prajapati, which is another version of Brahma, and we can see that when we go to... This is Veda.net, and we can see that Mrigashira, which is the antelope's head, that is representing the Orion constellation. And this is also what you will see if you listen to the United Lodge of Theosophy. So this central point, which is actually the head of Prajapati, or Brahma the Creator, this is actually meant to be in the Orion constellation. Okay, so that's important because the Orion constellation by the Hindi people is viewed differently than it is in other parts of the world. And this is one of the reasons why I've never taken astrology that serious, because the symbolism in astrology, for example, may be different across culture, right? So when they say born of a virgin, if it's fine if you're comparing it to Greek philosophy, but if you're not comparing it to Greek philosophy and you're looking at some other version of the cosmos by some other culture, it all falls apart. And that's the reason why I've never taken that stuff too seriously. But there are some things that you can find. This head of the Prajapati, or Brahma the Creator, he has the form of a deer or an antelope's head, Mriga Shira, and this is the same as the Orion constellation. Okay, this is the head area. All right, so when we come back over here in this drawing right here, and this is Prajapati, we can see that there are some different ways, and this was done, I believe, this particular one was done in the 1800s or 1700s, but there's more stuff to be seen around surrounding this. But let's take a look at the first part here. This area down here that you're looking at, let's take a look at that. So if you see this is a turtle, right? And this is a turtle's back, and what's growing out of this turtle's back? And then we have this lotus flower, right? This little lotus flower that's sitting at the top of this triangle, okay? Now, this ties us to the Mayan creation myths, because if we take a look at the Mayan creation myths, we have the maize god growing out of the turtle, so it's the same depiction, and that turtle represents the three stars in the Orion constellation. And the head of this guy is right where the Orion Nebula is. And this right here is kind of showing us a miniature view of where the turtle stars are. Everybody's familiar with the turtle stars and the Mayan pyramids and everything like that. So this is the maize god on his turtle. Here's Prajapati on his turtle, okay? Then we have what's called the churning of the sea of milk, all right? And these are other pictures of what we might consider the creator god, but you see the churning of the sea of milk. When we talk about the sea, let me show you a close-up of this. It's another turtle, okay? Here's another one right here. It's another turtle down here. And here's one right here. It's another turtle. It's the same depiction. And what these guys are actually doing is they are churning the milk of the sea. Now, the milk of the sea is the sea of space. And it is the cosmos. And it is showing a turning motion like we would see with a galaxy. But Prajapati is concerned with Orion. And what do we find in Orion? Well, what we find in Orion is the exact same thing that we would find in the center of the galaxy. We find what I discovered a year before NASA did. Let me show you real quick. Now, most people are aware, and if you're not yet, I'll remind you again that NASA confirmed what I had found based on cathedral art a long time ago. In these cathedrals I had found in November, I think it was 2011, that based on what I was seeing in these cathedrals, that there was this, looked like to be a black hole in the center of the Orion Nebula Trapezium. Now that is a quite a specific thing to say. However, they came out a year later and they said, we believe that there's a black hole in the center of the Orion Nebula. You can call that luck if you want, but the odds of that, of me being lucky on something like that, are highly unlikely. I mean, the odds are very extreme. So So that's interesting. So what we see is we have this creation coming into existence. So if we go back to where the way this creation moves down, we have this invisible thing coming down and then popping into creation. And that would be considered Kether. Kether is the first point, the smooth point. And in Kabbalah, it's also referred to as the prima mobile, or the first movement, or the nebula, or the fiery heavens. All of this stuff is confirmed in Kabbalah. So, with that, let's come back over here, and we see this this motion of what's happening right here, him standing on top of the turtle, but this time we have this churning of the milk going on, okay? So, this was found later on, and this is on space.com, this cosmic slinky. Now, check out and see what's going on here. You notice that they are spinning this. They're churning this around, right? On space.com, we have this cosmic slinky. And guess where it sits? Is right where the Orion Nebula is. This churning of the milk, the curdles of the sea, which is also what they have called this area out inside of the, you know, when they're talking about nebulas and stuff, they're talking about curdles of milk. And this is the churning of the milk of the sea right here. Okay. Now it's also, remember, it's called the head of the creator. So when we take a look at things like, for example, the creation of Adam, where I showed you that God in that cloud area it's actually a head turned sideways looking to the right, which is exactly the same, which is mentioned as Kether, which is an old bearded king with his face and right profile that we always see in Kabbalah. So all this is all tying together, okay? So with the Mayans, we have what's called Ladante. Now this I had to access this on the web archive because it's gone now. From 2010, it's gone. But this shows the three hearthstones of creation, and in the middle, which is the area of fire, this is considered the area of creation. I'll just let that replay one more time for you. So there's the three. Now that's the Ladante pyramid, the largest pyramid in the El Tigre complex, and if you notice, those three smaller pyramids on top correspond to Alnitek, Rigel, and Sife, these guys. In the middle, you have that fire, right? Okay, well, let's just jump back over here real quick. And here is another version of what we see as well. Yajna, which is born to Prajapati, okay? So if when we take a look at that video, I'm going to supply you a link for, it's also represented as sacrifice. And it was also said that Orion, by these old Greek philosophers, walked on the water, just like they talk about Jesus, okay? So let's go back here. We have this image again. All right. And here is the egg. Okay. And by the way, this is actually a picture of this. You see that platform? Just like that's the platform of fire. That represents the Orion Nebula, the area of creation. And here's what they've got it tied to. This is actually what you see when you go there and you take a look at this. You can see that this area of fire represents this platform, which represents creation. Okay. So this is what the Mayans believed. The Mayans show the maize god coming out of the turtle's back, which is the belt of Orion, with his head reaching right here in the center. Okay, so here's our area of creation. And this, what we see right here with this lotus flower at the top here of this triangle. This is where the eye of the triangle is, and when we take a look at the right here, we see the same thing. This is that lotus flower, which is the eye, and sits inside the triangle, and this is found in a very old carvings in this rock that dates who knows how back far into the future, into the past. But we can see the Orion's belt, and we can see the eye, which represents the first part that comes into existence. Okay, so now, and you have to keep, you have to tie all this stuff together, and you can see the consistencies across culture. Now we have over here, this is the Yoga Vasistha, and this is also Hindi, right? And it's called the germinating seed. And it talks about how mind moves down into physical reality. So, during this movement down, we have this ego that is created. Not ego in a bad sense. Its ego means identity. It means that it is I, basically. It means it is the self-realization of itself, right? And so it says, as the intellect, the soul, the mind, the maya or delusion, and prakriti or nature, the ego personified as Rudra, the personification of citta, cogitation is Vishnu, of jiva or the soul is Brahma, and of the manas or mind is the maya illusion. Okay, mind, which is the subject of thoughts, contemplates. Now imagine this, you're this mind, and you're contemplating on the nature of elementary matter, the first pieces of matter that come into existence. And in our cosmos, we see things like hydrogen, stuff like this. So it becomes these five elements. The mind is opposed to matter, but being the principle of volition, produces matter at its will. The quintessential mind, okay, so now you're this mind, and the next thing that happens as you move down into creation is you become a spark of fire of itself and remains as a dim star, a nebula in the midst of the vacuity of the yet born, unborn universe. Okay, so the first thing that happens, you have this movement from spirituality down to mind, and then the spark of fire of itself, which is mind. Okay, now that's, it's important, because let me show you something. So we have a spark of itself, which is called mind, and this is the Orion Nebula, and that is exactly what we're looking at when we look at the creation of Adam. We're looking at a picture of the mind becoming a spark of itself. So what science will never get is that these kinds of things can be tested. It's just that it's not, and you can see the consistencies across culture. It's just not the same form of the type of testing that you would do in modern physical materialistic research. Okay? It takes somebody with the ability to be able to think outside of that box. But they're already talking about things like spooky action at a distance and stuff like this. These are all things that have been confirmed a long time ago, thousands of years ago in Hermetic philosophy, but they'll never give them the credit for that. But here we go. So we have mind moving down from this invisible point and moving into a physical universe, and that becomes the spark of fire of itself, the spark of fire of creation, which is a dim star mentioned in the Yoga Vasistha. A dim star, a nebula in the midst of the yet unborn universe. The nebula are the primary formations of heavenly bodies called brahmandas or mundane eggs. So when we come back over here and take a look at Prajapati, we see the golden egg. This is also the Big Bang universe, or the Big Bang theory, comes from a Jesuit priest who called it the cosmic egg, is what he called it. I wonder where he got that from, since all of the ancient cultures used this to begin with. See, they think it's all based on just religious concepts, but it's not. It's also based on science as well. They don't realize that. They don't give him any credit. Last thing I'm going to do is I'll post a link to this, but I'm going to play part of this for you. Because a long time ago, when I started seeing the symbolism and I started seeing it come together, and this is from January 1st. Isn't that interesting? It's about almost a year ago, exactly. So when I saw this coming together a long time ago, no, it would be 2 years ago, wouldn't it? This is the way I saw it coming together and the way that Manly Hall describes it. And this also ties to the Egyptian stuff, because Manly, and this is where you're going to see Manly Hall pick up with this in this particular video, because he mentions that the first one is Ta, right? And Ta is the light of the mind and the light of the world. Okay? And when we take a look at the Egyptian, Ta is the light of the mind and the light of the world. And he's number one. So we have this pre-creation, which is I was speaking of, moving down into creation. And these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, this is what you would see as far as the Sephiroth on the Tree of Life. The planets and these things. And these represent, the nebula represents the head of the creation. Because if you take a look at the Tree of Life, the human body fits on the Tree of Life, and the head is at the very top. The head is near Kether. And this is also gone into by many various points of Kabbalah. I mean, there's so many connections here. I can't go into all of them for you, but I wanted to show you mainly the connection between Prajapati, or Brahma, the creator god. And you can see right here. And the maize god, same thing. It's tied to Orion. Prajapati is tied to Orion. The churning of the milk, the cosmic slinky, the Ladanta pyramid, it's tied to the Orion constellation, and this area right here, which is the birth of it all. What we actually see from that complex text from the Yoga Vasistha. And there was the germinating seed. We also have another one, but this shows the movement from mind down into creation. And then all these various Buddhism, Taoism, it's all the same. They all do the same kind of thing. They all move from this pre-creation, invisible type universe. And this is Jewish Kabbalah here. We have Ein, Ein Sof, Ein Sof, Or, and then Kether, the first one, first mobile, right? And this represents the fiery waters or the or fiery heavens. So you can see how it's all coming together. You can see how these cultures around the world all seem to point to this area, and that is extremely important. And we can see that it was even carried on esoterically into these cathedrals as well. It wasn't a joke that I, or some kind of a weird coincidence that I found the Orion Nebula and these cathedrals and started branching out from there. It was simply good analysis. And NASA proved me right, and all these various things I keep finding across culture are proving me right. This area right here, although it's not the birth of our galaxy, it has some kind of a role in creation when it with regards to humanity itself. And I'm not really sure as to what exactly, but this also goes all the way back into the Atlantis portion of our history as well. Because all of these societies branched off. They all, for example, the Mayans over in the Western culture, they pointed to Orion, the Mayans did. And then over on in the Africa, the Egyptians pointed to Orion with the pyramid. Same thing. Pyramid is a way of showing creation as it moves from the very top and moves down. Same thing that we would see with the Tetractys with Pythagoras. It's all the same. And we see the same type of thing happening all around the world. It originally came from probably before the last fragment sunk, came from Atlantis. So this spans back a very, very, very long time ago in our history. And it's helping me tie the Atlantis piece of this together. What I'm going to do is I'm going to put a part of this video in the last of this for you so you guys can check out and kind of visualize in your head as Manly Hall talks kind of how things started moving into creation. All right, so I hope that was interesting to you guys. You guys take care. I'll talk to you soon. Oh,
We are not therefore surprised to discover that the Egyptians early recognized Osiris as one deity within which a division of deities took place. Isis, Nephthys, Anubis, Typhon, Horus, these deities were not separate from Osiris. They were the very parts and members of himself. He recognized Osiris in four principal attributes or forms. And these in themselves should tell us that we stand at the gate of a great philosophy. Osiris was first Osiris Tar. Tar was the light of the mind and the light of the world. But it was more than intellect. It was the light which enlightened intellect. Osiris Tar was a potter. He was a great artificer, and he fashioned all things upon a potter's wheel in the Nome of Memphis. Osiris Tar fashioned first the great age of the world, from which sprang forth both gods and men. Osiris Tar was also the architect. The base and substance of those archetypal designs which are to be everywhere manifested in creation.
Then there came forth from that place the cloud of the great light, the living power, the mother of the holy, incorruptible ones, the great power, the Nerotha, and she gave birth to him. For this one, Adamus, is a light which radiated from the light. He is the eye of the light, for this is the first man, he through whom and to whom everything came into being, without whom nothing came into being. The unknowable, incomprehensible Father came forth. He came down from above for the annulment of the deficiency. Great Logos, the divine autogenes, and the incorruptible man Adamus mingled with each other. A Logos of man came into being. However, the man came into being through a word.
Having projected the archetype of creation,
creates an instrument by means of which it can move into its own archetype. This instrument is archetypal man, the symbol of Manus, the mind thinker.
This is the age of planetary exploration.
This mysterious shadowy archetype was a perfect, magnificent, heroic creature, almost in itself a god, yet a product of a god. And into this archetype, all of the essentials and essences of the divine nature were united, so that truly it was the noblest work of the Creator, and was really a kind of projection of himself. There may be a parallel to this in the idea of Osiris being reborn in his own son Horus. And here we find the peculiar relationship of father and son. The father who is his own son. The son who is his own father. The son who is the only begotten of the father. This is intellect, or the power of reason, given dominion over the works of consciousness. We know from the ancient manuscripts and from the various appellatives applied to deities that everything that's said is actually included among the titles given to deities. Therefore, we are not exaggerating. Horus, among his titles, includes the only begotten of Osiris. Also, another title is the firstborn of eternity. Another title of him is He Who Shall Bear Witness. Another title of him is the Redeemer. Still another, the Intercessor. He is also called the Bridge and the Door. And it is said of him that he guards the house of his father. The universal or divine mind becomes embodied in man himself. And then he divides man into two essential patterns. The first of these is the archetypal man, the total man. This total man is an image existing in cognition itself. This archetypal man may or may not be an image held in total completeness. It is quite conceivable that archetype itself carries in it the dimension of growth. But archetype also bears a strange relationship as totality to its own parts. As deity, being the creator of all things, projects creation and inhabits it. So, archetype, the archetypal man, the anthropos, is the source and collective unity of humanity, which is projected from it, which exists forever within it, is moved by it, and is gradually growing toward identity with its totality.
Thank you. We have now the possibility of man exploring God through examining the universe. And not only this possibility, but to the Kabbalist and most other mystics, the valid right to do this, even though it might upset some of the best theological institutions. And whether it was arrogance or insight, we may never know. But our ancestors came to the conclusion that the most complete working instrument by which the universal will can be made known is man himself. For it is said that God made man in his own image. Male and female created he them. He did not know how to weigh the arguments of one venerated teacher against the arguments of another who had arrived at a different conclusion. He therefore, as an individual, came to realize that there had to be some other way of knowing. There had to be a direct knowing. If there was not, there could be no end of uncertainty. There descended a great light or vitality from circumference of a great sphere to its center. In the center it formed the great eye, the eye of Kepha, the eye which is the eye of Israel, or the eye of the God of Israel, which neither slumbers nor sleeps, the great open eye that has no lid. And there emerged out of the mystery of infinite being the gigantic figure like the giant of the vision of Nebuchadnezzar. a mysterious and colossal figure with one foot upon the oceans and the other upon the land, around whose body the stars and planets moved, and whose face was always in profile. As an isolated and lonely creation. This is the mysterious, primordial, archetypal, universal man. And this man, in the Hermetic doctrine, is the one and only begotten Son of the Father, the man which is the Son of the Mind.
The efforts have been made to parallel this man with the Christ of Christianity as the only begotten, and also strangely as the celestial Adam.
It was usually personified or impersonated as a most venerable person, a great superhuman being. A being, however, fashioned in the likeness of a man. A being like the mysterious and noble figure casting from his hands the sun and moon, as represented on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel in Rome.
A key to one part comes far towards opening all the rest of the mystery. We know that some of it has even reached into modern anatomy in names and words. We know that the upper axis of the spine, where it joins the skull, was known even in science as the pyramid.